a candy-colored clown they call the Sandman, tiptoes to my room every night, just to sprinkle stardust and to whisper, go to sleep, everything is all right. I close my eyes.
Established by the French poet Andrew Breton and heavily influenced by the work of Freud, the Surrealism movement has been prevalent since the early 1920s in all different forms of media. While Surrealism was originally rooted in artwork, the conventions have remained true when it comes to film and media. Surrealists' principal aim is to find means to disrupt the complacency of the dominant cultural traditions and establish the basis of a new way of thinking, and this remains true to Surrealist films, which strive to break traditional Hollywood conventions. Surrealism has impacted filmmaking for decades across all genres of film, from arthouse classics such as Last Year at Marienbad, contemporary critical and commercial successes such as Spike Jonze's Being John Malkovich. Described by Hayward as films concerned with depicting the workings of the unconscious, and by Combs as films with narratives that confront the conventions of Hollywood storytelling, Surrealist filmmaking is extremely unique and diverse. Perhaps no modern-day filmmaker has been as prevalent in Surrealist cinema than David Lynch.
Fucking A, man!
Described as the most high-profile purveyor of the surreal and a realizer of the subconscious, Lynch has been making surrealist media for over 50 years. After bursting on the scene with 1977's unforgettable Eraserhead, Lynch has continued to innovate and inspire, creating his own subgenre of surrealism filmmaking, known as Lynchian. This term has been described by Devlin as a confusing labyrinth in which one can easily become lost. Genre of films that can distort and disrupt viewers' expectation of a traditional approach to narrative and storyline, plot points, character development, frame composing, and film styling. A common misconception of Lynch is that he is just a creator of the bizarre and macabre, and that his films, and Surrealist films in general, are bizarre just because they can be. With this video essay, I want to show how Lynch uses Surrealist elements, such as cinematography, narrative, and other filmic microfeatures, in order to aid in creating a unique atmosphere and emotion in his films that cannot be found anywhere else.
It's a magical thing, and you don't want to know so much that would, you know, stop it from happening.
Throughout his body of work, David Lynch has used surrealism to a high effect to create a dreamlike atmosphere. Stevens describes his films as dream worlds that engulf their audiences, imprisoning them in a world where fantasy and ambiguity reign. This atmosphere is a key convention of surrealist cinema, and is achieved by Lynch in a number of different ways, from his use of illogical musical sections, otherworldly yet endearing characters,
I feel as though my stomach is filled with a team of bumblebees,
and unconventional cinematography, such as long drawn-out shots. Take Twin Peaks. Lynch uses techniques to create a haunting atmosphere, which A refers to a surrealist dream logic. Unconventional uses of editing, such as fades, unique and complex cinematography, and mise-en-scene, all help build an atmosphere. In Twin Peaks, Lynch anchors audiences with scenes of routine, high schools, diners, and family dinners, and uses this apparent normalness and stability as a method to build an atmosphere, ready for the subversion of the dream world. A weirdness and an insanity that creates a heightened dream atmosphere which would not be possible without the use of surrealism.
That's very satisfying to know what's going on. But at the same time, I love abstractions. And the power of cinema to tell abstractions is huge.
A dreamlike atmosphere is further achieved by Lynch through his toying with traditional storytelling. A multitude of his films are told unchronologically, which creates a suspenseful atmosphere and makes the audience engaged and constantly questioning. Neil McCartney comments on how Lynch's films often follow narrative conventions before suddenly switching to a dream logic pattern, in which our assumptions about characters and storylines are often thrown into disarray. Take Inland Empire, which uses this technique to great effect. Released in 2006 and filmed entirely in low-quality analog equipment, Inland Empire tells an out-of-order story that is intentionally often lacking concentration. The first hour of the film is presented completely straight, with a chronological narrative.
You have a new role to play, I hear.
Up for a role.
But this, alongside the life of protagonist Nikki, completely decays, becoming chaotic and unconnected. This technique is used multiple times in Lynch films in order to help build an atmosphere, making the audience identify less with the plot and more with the uncanny experiences of the roles that they, the characters, are driven to play.
This sounds like dialogue from our script!
The spectator feels just as confused as the characters are, helping build this dreamlike atmosphere as we attempt to work out what's happening. In Inland Empire, this is achieved by presenting multiple timelines and seemingly unconnected plot points together. This includes a sitcom about human rabbits. This narrative forces a dreamlike atmosphere on the audience, and, as Jerslev mentions, presents a story where boundaries between past and present are blurred, and where we have no choice but to adjust to the ever new point of views.
I can't seem to remember if it's today, 2 days from now, or yesterday.
This surrealist narrative, which is mirrored in other Lynch works such as Mulholland Drive, works with the previously mentioned filmic microfeatures to build a dreamlike atmosphere and quality to Lynch's work, which is essential when it comes to creating emotional engagement from the audience.
Sure, the movie's well made, but the more I thought about it, the less I liked it.
Well, I liked it, and I thought about it a lot.
Surrealist films, including Lynch's work, are decisive in nature, often polarized critics and general audiences.
I liked it. I've seen it 5 times.
It's the weirdest thing I've ever seen.
This is almost what Lynch and other surrealists want to achieve, and by using surrealist features, Lynch is able to create a wide range of emotional responses from the audience, from fear to unease.
Beautiful evening.
Yeah.
To even happiness and joy.
I heard you again. I heard you again.
The key way Lynch is able to create this emotion, especially fear and unease, is by blending surreal or sinister elements with mundane, everyday environments. Take the set design and use of curtains and red drapes in his films. Or the use of mirrors and reflection, which can be seen in surrealist filmmaking throughout the years alongside Lynch's work. These mundane objects are juxtaposed with the surreal and sinister elements of Lynch's films in order to unconsciously create fear and unease in the audience, reminding them that strangeness can be anywhere. Lynch simulates emotions of profound intensity in his films, and he does this through his characters, by making us sympathize with them. Lynch also uses sound to great effects when building emotion, with musical cues, composed masterfully by Angelo Badalamenti, creating emotional augmentation through sound alone.
We now return to How David Lynch Stole Christmas.
Hello, I got you a present. It's a thumb.
Huh?
Don't look away. Let the fear wash over you.
I don't understand.
That's the whole point.
Despite the often polarizing response to his films, Lynch's success and ability to engage the audience is undeniable.
Thank you all very much.
He and his films have won plaudits throughout the years, and for many people, myself included, they would categorize him as one of their favorite directors. He has had great success in the box office despite often limited releases, and his films are continuously high up on the list of the greatest of all time. This is greatly due to how Lynch uses surrealism to aid in creating a specific emotional response, one that challenges the viewer to embrace the world of the marvelous, the dream, the abject, and the irrational. If there was one thing that could perfectly summarize the work, intention, and filmmaking style of David Lynch, it would be a comment he made back in 1989 when making Wild at Heart. He said, "I don't know why people expect art to make sense. They accept the fact that life doesn't make sense." This perfectly summarizes why Lynch uses surrealist elements in his productions, and is one of the most important filmmakers who has paid attention to surrealism. He creates an atmosphere and emotion that is extremely unique and cannot be found many places elsewhere. Lynch's films have great impact on audiences, breaking traditional cinematic conventions creatively and inspiring filmmakers of the future, such as Ari Aster and Boots Riley, who would not be making the groundbreaking surrealist films they currently make if Lynch had not paved the way.
Incredible.